the religion department, who was working on a book examining the Middle East process, and the Jewish philosophy. Taking aside from Christianity will be Dr. Phil Fernandez, founder and president of the Institute for Biblical Defense in the Seattle area of Washington. Dr. Fernandez received his PhD in philosophy of religion from Greenwich University and currently teaches at Kentucky Bible College. He has lectured and debated in defense of Christianity at a number of universities across the country. I'd also like to thank the sponsors of tonight's debate, as well as those individuals who helped make it possible, particularly Larry Jones and Christine Darrow. Please take a few moments after the debate to look at the various materials to your left there. The format of tonight's debate will be as follows. Dr. Fernandez will speak for 20 minutes. Mr. Ratzmann will then speak for 20 minutes. Then there will be 10 minute rebuttals and time for questions. Princeton philosophy professor Amy Rosen will be our moderator. Please join me in welcoming Professor Rosen.
Pretend you have no opinion on the question whether God exists, whether the Christian God exists, whether secularism is correct or not. Pretend you're open-minded. Pretend you want to know the answer to this question. And now, see what these two guys can do to persuade you one way or the other. Even if you do have an opinion, your assessment as to the rationality of that opinion should turn on how persuasive you think these remarks and similar remarks might be. So, see what you can do to assess this sort of debate in that spirit, and I won't go on. Let's start with Dr. Fernandez.
I'd like to thank Vincent Lloyd for inviting me to this debate, Elliot Ratzmann for agreeing to debate me, and Gideon Rosen for agreeing to moderate this debate. I just want to let you know I consider it an honor to speak at Princeton. In fact, the last and only time I was at Princeton was in 1975. I was at Stafford High School on the corner of A's in Jersey. And back in 75, I competed in ninth grade state track meet. So it's been a long time. And let's just hope that I do better tonight than I did in 75. Otherwise, I probably won't be back at Princeton for another 26 years. Tonight, I will defend what C.S. Lewis called mere Christianity. This is the belief that a personal God exists who has uniquely revealed himself in and through Jesus of Nazareth. I will provide evidence that it is more reasonable to believe in the existence of a personal God than it is to reject his existence. I will also show that the historical data accepted by the majority of New Testament scholars today is more plausibly explained by the resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth than by any alternative theory. The beginning of the universe. This argument is as follows. Whatever began to exist must have a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore the universe had a cause. Premise number one uses the law of causality. Non-being cannot cause being. In other words, from nothing, nothing comes. Since nothing is nothing, it can do nothing. Therefore, it can cause nothing. Hence, whatever began to exist needs a cause for its existence. Premise number two contends that the universe had a beginning. Scientific evidence for the beginning of the universe includes the second law of thermodynamics, also known as energy deterioration, and the Big Bang model. Second law of thermodynamics is one of the most firmly established laws of modern science. It states that the amount of usable energy in a closed system is running down. It means that someday in the finite future, all the energy in the universe will be useless, unless there is intervention from outside the universe. In other words, if left to itself, the universe will have an end. But if the universe is going to have an end, it had to have a beginning. At one time in the finite past, all the energy in the universe was usable. Since the universe is winding from nothing, nothing comes. The Big Bang model also indicates that the universe is beginning. This model shows that as time moves forward, the universe is expanding in all directions, much like the effects of an explosion. But this means that if we were able to go back in time, the physical universe would get smaller and smaller until there would be no physical universe. Scientists call this point endless space, or point of infinite density. Therefore, the physical universe began out of nothing a finite time ago. This means that space, matter, and time had a beginning. Since the universe had a beginning, it had to have a cause. Once again, for from nothing, nothing comes. But to reach this present effect called the universe, there had to have been an eternal, uncaused first cause. For it is impossible to traverse an infinite set of causes and effects to reach the present effect. There had to be a first cause. Since intelligence cannot come from non-intelligence, the cause of the universe must be an intelligent. Since nature is non-moral, but morality exists in the universe, the cause of the universe must be a moral being. This means that the cause of the universe is a personal being. The design and order found in the universe. The order, design, and complexity found in the universe strongly imply that the universe is not a random together of atoms. Rather, it is the product of intelligent design. Therefore, it had an intelligent designer. Contemporary scientists have found numerous evidences for design in the universe. A few examples will suffice. First, the slightest variation in the expansion rate of the universe would render the universe capable of sustaining life. Second, astrophysicist Ulos has listed 25 narrowly defined parameters that the universe had to have in order for life to be possible. Ross also pointed out 32 narrowly defined parameters for life concerning the Earth, its moon, its sun, and its galaxy. For instance, if the distance between the Earth and the sun was to differ by just 2% in either direction, no life on